So, this is a first for me being a DM, but me and my friends have discussed that we'd like to try to continue streaming the sessions that we do, considering we're having a lot of fun with this campaign. I wanted to do something a little unique and out of the ordinary, so I decided to give my players a little bit of free rein in terms of their character creation. One of the first people decided that they wanted to become one of the monsters in the campaign, and that only spurred that much more creation down the road. I'd like to introduce you to some. So, the first two we're going to reveal are Graw and Sporecap. Graw is a Boulette barbarian who is not incredibly talkative, very gravelly voiced, and someone who is more of an observant type than an interactive type. Sporecap, ironically similarly enough, is that way as well. However, Sporecap has the disadvantage of not really being able to speak, but desperately wanting to try to communicate in some way, shape, or form. I introduced these two because at the start of the campaign, all of the characters were separated in one way, shape, or form, and these were the first two to interact with each other. Going to quickly pop over to our little bit of overworld. I'm using Faerun as our world, and to give you an idea of what things look like and where people were at the before everything started. As you can see, Graw and Sporecap were down near this little Shilmasta forest section. Graw was venturing, and Sporecap was in the forest looking for something in particular. And Graw noticed Sporecap out in the distance and thought it was interesting seeing a large mushroom walking around. Eventually, a band of monster hunters had captured them, brought them up to Easting, a small little village, and Easting was not willing to house them or execute them, but got word from the mayor of Elversalt that there was interest there. So they were brought over upon the mayor's request. Next on our little party are these three: Shadow, Carl the Mimic, and some more pain. We have a roguish kobold, an artificer mimic, and a Death Knight paladin. The Death Knight paladin is a little bit of a homebrew creation in that there are some abilities that are from the Death Knight character creation that we wanted to scale down, obviously, but also still incorporate for the fun factor. As you might have seen on the previous map selection, they were a little bit to the north of Elversalt when they all ran into each other, all venturing in three separate directions, but coming to a singular point. The kobold noticing first a chest walking around, the chest immediately reacting and trying to disguise itself as such, but perplexing the kobold that there is a chest out in the open, and whether or not it was walking around to begin with had a weird influence. Wanting to go investigate due to the inquisitive nature, Shadow got close to Carl. Carl, wanting to look for a nice little meal, was patiently waiting, but Shadow had noticed a pair of red eyes walking in the distance toward their direction and immediately tried to hide. The red eyes belonged to some more, and again, a creature of moderate intelligence, wondering why a chest out in the open field, went to kick over the chest. Carl, immediately reacting, sprung its arms and legs out, turned around, and asked if the Death Knight which didn't seem like food due to the undead nature, asked anyway. A minor confrontation had occurred between the three, excuse me, but they all decided that they were going to try to work together and started heading south from the direction, ironically enough, that Carl was coming from. They got to this moderately sized town of Proskir in the, near the Sunset and Stormhorn Mountains when they noticed the people there were incredibly active, even at night. Unnaturally so. They tried to do their best to stay out of sight and keep the people unaware. However, Samur, being a character who has heavy armor, definitely tipped off the people of the town. They grabbed their pitchforks, their dogs, and tried to chase them down. Samur, being a more noble, or noble not necessarily being the right term, but honorable fighter, tried to defend himself and stand his ground. Carl, not necessarily having the most skill with running away, tripped and fell and was quickly captured. Shadow got the farthest, but could not outrun the dogs that were after him. Eventually went into a fetal position and laid capture. The mayor of Proskir had nothing to do with them, but again got word from the mayor of Elversalt that there was interest there. And our next little group of people of interest, the last member of our party, is Yorn. Yorn is a cleric, human cleric, who, to be upfront, is a death cleric. A cleric who prays to a god Mercule, has made that very obvious in the streams thus far. But due to his sinister affiliations, was not treated the most fairly by people he was around, and was eventually taken in by the mayor of Elversalt, Ram Fassad. Ram is a very charismatic figure, led his way to power, and was looking to rebuild Elversalt to its once former glory and beyond. His goal, all in all, is to look for the city becoming on par with the coastal cities to the east, or excuse me, the west, with your Neverwinters, your Waterdeeps, and your Baldur's Gates. In terms of size and population and just the amount of control he wants. His aspirations are ambitious, but don't necessarily seem out of the norm. At least he has made it seem as though they are not out of the norm. His request, as he made obvious to Yorn and his captain of the guard, Sir Arthur Penwood, was to bring in as many monsters as possible, determine whether or not they were capable of understanding the common tongue, and use them to fulfill a military request to deal with a goblin horde that was intersecting shipments between various trading cities and military shipments out to the east. He decided that this would be fortuitous in that it would provide more military contracts down the road, providing more money to the city, and thus making it more prosperous, or having the ability of making the city more prosperous. This brings us to the town of Elversalt, where all of our heroes ended up lying in the pits of the dungeon. Rom was eventually brought to them and questioned them whether or not they were willing to comply and whether or not they were willing to partake in a mission that would prove potentially suicidal. A little bit of backstory that had yet to be revealed, or has yet to be revealed to the party at large, but there was strife between Rom and Sir Arthur Penwood. Sir Arthur was requesting that him and a few of the town's guard themselves be sent on this mission, and why would they ever try to contract monsters to do it? Rom had thought that it was far too important for the city guard to be sent away in case any other attack from a potential branch off of this goblin horde were to attack the town at its weakest. Sir Arthur Penwood understood, complied, very begrudgingly so. And so did our heroes. They did so in order to, because they were promised their potential freedom. Rom sent them out on this mission, and Penwood was sent with them as a way of maintaining them. Preventing them from just running away, preventing them from just outright dying. He was meant to be as a caretaker to them, which confused Penwood in a sense because he didn't fully understand as why they were being sent on a suicide mission if he was meant to be a shepherd for them. Bringing us to our first encounter. One moment, please. Our first encounter was a fairly large batch of goblins that were dressed in tatters, had ambushed our party after about a day or two's journey to the east, and Penwood had stayed far back, letting them deal with the horde. In this particular battle, the heroes did not do incredibly well, poor rolls and all, but we were able to dispatch a good chunk of the goblins that were there, and we were able to find a new ability that one of our party members was capable of doing. Those that died via the goblins, or from those of the goblins that died in a very gruesome manner. So, unfortunately, our character Sporecap here was not able to harvest as many as he could, but the three goblins he was able to rise once again. They are considered zombies, or excuse me, plants, under his control for a certain amount of time. After a couple of minutes of investigation, they were able to discern that a foot traffic path was visible, leading our party down this path here, leading them to the mouth of a very large cave. Oh, sorry. There we go. At the entrance of the cave, they were able to fight more goblins. These a little bit better dressed and a little bit better armed. Unfortunately, Sporecap had lost one of his servants. They decided at the branching path to head to the left, encountered three more goblins. and then tried to do their best to stay quiet and lead themselves to this larger antechamber. Our boulette creature, Graw, thought it would be a good idea to try to sneak his way in by digging underground and trying to find a way of maneuvering a path that would be less obvious. In doing so, he triggered the attention of a warg that was in there and was able to evade any attacks from him, but the warg then noticed the party at large in the back. The fight ensued. It ended up triggering later the little pack of goblins that were on the right path into this larger antechamber and frightened a hobgoblin that ran to the left. In this antechamber, they were able to see that bodies, humanoid bodies, were strewn about. Not a terrible amount, but enough that made them wary as to why they were uninformed. They ventured left toward where the hobgoblin had run, and encountered three more goblins. They dispatched them very quickly. Graw thought it'd be a good idea and tried to go underground and attack from below. However, due to a miscommunication in messaging, Graw had burst through the ground to attack one of the goblins, outright killing it, but our character Shadow had also claimed attack on said goblin and ended up shooting Graw as he burst out of the ground. They all complained that they were tired, that they were worn, that they had taken some substantial damage. And Arthur, realizing that they had triggered an event that would require efficacy of timing, had allowed the party to take a short rest. They rested in this little alcove, saw that the goblins were looking through the corpse of a dead man and child, and on the man's pockets, they had noticed a small little note written in Dwarvish. Ironically enough, for a party of six and fairly well linguist creatures we have, they were not able to speak Dwarvish. So they tried to hand the note over to Penwood to see what he could discern, and he was only able to pull out three words: treasures, bedroom, and chest. The party took what they could from that, and Penwood seemed to grow more amenable to them, seeing as that they were becoming more and more effective at dispatching the goblins than he initially had thought. The next session led to the party then venturing from their short rest outwards left, further down the path, and getting to a very large closed door. Graw, again thinking on his feet, decided burrowing underground would be the best idea, considering he has the ability of detecting movement above ground within a certain distance. He ventured in a little bit, noticed a particular creature that was visible in his sense, decided that he would reinform the party of the location of the creature, and that they should peek through the door and take a look and see if it was a potential target for him to attack. They peeked through the door, let him know, and he made his movement to the spot. He would wait for them to bust through the door before he made his attack, thus not triggering a chain reaction of now all fires focused at him and not at the door. Due to the hobgoblin running away, they were prepared. They were successfully able to open the door, however, But do but the goblins and hobs were a bit more prepared in that they trapped the alchemist's fire above the door, and when it had opened, had poured down and ignited a couple of our adventuring party. Gra, not knowing, had heard the commotion and had burst through the ground and attacked our little hob that was standing there. All in all, it ended up the spur of the battle had ended up involving Penwood more. Instead of him being a backside character, had decided that it would be better for him to stand in the front line with all of these fighters. They had noticed that this was another larger room, filled with tables and candles and what would have been food but had all been eaten. It was a very large dining area. Due to the light that Penwood was able to see coming through the bottom of the next door to the lower portion of the room, he had suggested that they check that out first. Gra, not necessarily being on the best terms of Penwood at the time, thought it might be best to check the upper door. As soon as he had gotten within a couple of feet of it, the entire party had heard an enormous bellowing roar come from the upper door. It shook the party to its core. They decided to follow Penwood and deal with that later, or hopefully not have to deal with it at all. They ventured down, attacked a couple more goblins and hobs, and made their way finally into this last little room here. Busting through the door as best as they could, they triggered an attack that these hobs and goblins knew that were coming, but had seen more bodies laying on the floor and had started to realize that this m was a mine that was that this was a mine belonging to a dwarvish people, and that these hobs and gobs have taken it over. They looked through the room to find anything of note. They found a little bit of money and some better equipment in terms of just highly regarded swords and shields and such, but this was all most likely due to the various raiding attacks that had happened on the route being interfered with by this hobgoblin party. In one of the dressers, they were able to find a large key with an arcane sigil on it. They couldn't have seen what the key went to, so they decided to hold on to it. They then ventured back up into the larger mess hall and finally got to the door where they heard the bellow once more. Shaken, but still standing fast, decided that they were going to continue on through the door, doing their best at stealthing and staying quiet and seeing far, far more dead people. They tried to peek around every corner as they went further and further down this pathway. And just before the last turn, due to a failed stealth check, there was a voice that rang out from the large room. And this is where we'll introduce our first villain of the campaign. Fubar, Brawlmaster, an 8 foot tall shit brick shit house of an orc who had two very large wargs on each of his sides, had been huffing and puffing in this mine. I'm switching back now. Had been huffing and puffing in this mine.
had the wargs at his side. The party had entered, his presence, their presence and his presence, very well aware of each other. He had seen them and realized that they had cleaned out the entire mine, but he cared not of it whatsoever. He saw them all as a joke, both the goblins and hobgoblins that they had dispatched, and then them themselves, except for Penwood. He ended up challenging Penwood to a fight. Penwood agreed to one-on-one combat, and Fubar had made it very obvious that if the party had gotten involved in any way, that he would sick his dogs on them. A very cinematic fight had ensued that left Penwood in a very dire straits moment. The party acted and tried to defend their new ally. It then led to them fighting with a couple of wargs. They were able to kill one, wound another, but all in all, Fubar was able to dispatch and behead Penwood. The gore and damage he was able to do was excessively brutal, leaving the larger body in a 6 to 8 inch crater in the ground, and what was a plate armor now scraps of metal. All in all, Fubar had seen this as fair trade. The party decided that they would still try to uphold arms against him, and in a single turn was able to knock out and not kill three of the party members, all Sporecap, Carl, and Samur. Again, said fair trade, and walked away with his warg. Tending to their wounds, taking a rest, they tried to recover themselves, mourn the dead, and saw on the far right end of the room a very large door with dwarvish rune inscribing going along it, and had seen the key that they had also glow. They entered the key, the door had opened, removed the key, and then saw the chest in the room. In the chest, they were able to find a little bit of money that stayed to the party, and a very nice maul that was rather large, that had two dwarven heads on each side, and when they had grabbed it, those who had seen it be pulled out of the chest, it had flickered a blue shimmer that radiated from the base of the shaft all the way to the maul head and ending in the dwarven eyes on each side. It interested the party, but they thought nothing more of it. Then the party had decided, or had thought about, what they were going to do and how they were going to best report their findings to those in Elversalt. After a little bit of deliberation and time, they decided that they would try to take what best remains they can of Penwood and try to show Rom that he fought valiantly, but they were able to do what was requested of them. In Rom's office, they spoke with him about the incident. Rom had taken it to heart and asked the party to follow them. They did, willingly. Rom had taken them to his personal chambers over in the corner of the room, holding the head of Penwood as he did. Rom entered. The room was darkly lit, and then they all entered one by one. And when they got in, oh, one moment, I'm sorry. And when they had gotten in, they had seen that Rom had thrown the head of Penwood onto a pile of table filled with meat, ribs, and just slabs of gore. Ended up saying, "Finally," turned to the party with a wicked grin on his face that was only minimized by the grin that ended from his chin, from his hip to his shoulder. And that's how the last session had ended. So we will pick up our next session every other Wednesday, starting next Wednesday, for those who are interested. A point of interest that I think I would like to tell everyone is that there are a couple house rules in effect. One of them being something that I haven't seen implemented, but it is a scarring house rule in that if any of our party members take in a single hit an attack that does more than half of their total health, they take a scar. It's randomly rolled as to where the location of the scar is, but if they accrue three scars in a single location, whether it be the head, the torso, the arms, or the legs, there is a massive penalty involved. They have been informed of this. A couple have already accrued scars, and we'll see how it rolls out in the future. Thank you all for listening, and I hope you will enjoy the show.